Klimt was already at his lifetime so highly paid. So there was no other painter in Austria who could demand such prices. And if you look at the female portraits, who were these persons? They were all coming from the upper class. There were wives of industrialists, of academic professors. So they really came from a very wealthy background.
Jedna osoba koja je lako mogla priuštiti Klimtove cene bio je Ferdinand Bloch Bauer, koji je stekao svoje bogatstvo preradom šećera. Naručio je portret svoje supruge Adele.
She surrounded herself with artists, composers. She had what they called a salon at the time. She had all these fabulous people, Richard Strauss and Wassermann. I mean, she had people, painters, poets, composers.
Klimt je bio jedan od umetnika koji su posećivali njen salon. On je postao i njen lični prijatelj. Ali koliko će naplatiti da naslika Adelin portret?
The price at that time was already extremely high. It was enormous. I think that it was as high as you could have acquired at that time a whole villa, a good land house, even in the suburbs in Vienna. It was that high.
Možda je i bilo skupo, ali Klimtovi portreti Adele će postati jedne od najpoznatijih slika 20. veka. Prvi je bio jedna od samo nekoliko slika iz čuvenog Klimtovog zlatnog perioda, tokom kojeg je radio vrlo dekorativne slike, nalik na kutije za nakit. Tu vidimo Adelu u vrlo raskošnoj haljini, ukrašenoj svetlucavim nakitom. Znamo da je Klimtu trebalo više od godinu dana da završi sliku i on ju je u tom periodu mnogo puta posjećivao i napravio preko 200 skica.
We know from portraits which he prepared for 1 year, just the preparation. That's just thinking about how I want to have the posture of this woman. How should she stand? Should she sit? Where should be the arms? And so Klimt really thought about all details, and he made sketches of all different postures. I think it makes sense if you think he had really a personal relationship to this woman. He made a kind of reference to her. Because, of course, by meeting so often the person, he gets to know her very well. And it's said, I mean, there are rumors that with some of the sitters, with some of the models, he had even a more close relationship, maybe some sentimental affairs too.
Na slikama svog zlatnog perioda, Gustav Klimt beleži zavodljivu i strastvenu prirodu ovih žena. Mnogi veruju da je Adela bila model za poljubac, jedan od najlepših senzualnih radova ikada stvorenih. Da li je Adela možda bila i Klimtova ljubavnica?
When I asked my mother, did Adele have a relationship with Klimt, she said, how dare you ask such a question? It was an intellectual friendship. But my mother would always say that, even if when she was 100% sure that the people had more than an intellectual friendship, that the time they had their affairs and didn't discuss it.
We know that he had many children, illegitimate children, with women whom he didn't marry, he never was married, but we do not know exactly how many children there are, who were the women. I mean, this is incredible that such a famous painter had so many liaisons who were just hidden.
Bez obzira na odnos između Adele i umetnika, Ferdinand i njegova supruga su bili oduševljeni slikom. Nije prošlo mnogo vremena pre nego što je portret Adele sa oduševljenjem prihvaćen od strane bečkog art establishmenta. Portret je postao centralni deo Klimtovih izložbi. Bloch Bauerovi su želeli još Klimtovih slika i uložili su u 4 njegova pejzaža, nastali između 1903. i 1916. godine. Tokom leta Klimt je voleo da pobegne iz svog ateljeja, u pravcu jezera blizu Salzburga.
This subject, to which Klimt returned time and again, held a special fascination for him. I think perhaps it was the combination of the natural geometry of the lake shore and then the buildings rising up, but with the steep hill behind them pushing forwards, that held an attraction for him, but also the great natural combination of colors.
Dok se šetao obalom jezera, bio je fasciniran efektom svetlosti na drveće i cveće. Kada bi se vratio u jesen, nailazio je na jednu prigušeniju paletu.
Here Klimt takes as his subject a birch forest, the innards of a forest, in a glade. There was a reflection of perhaps getting deep into nature, being at the very heart of things. In truth, it's a fairly restricted palette. Green representing the lichen climbing up the trees and the leaf canopy, the russet colours, earth colours for the floor, and then the lovely silvery colours on the tree trunks.
Tokom 10 godina, kuća na Elizabeth Strasse zračila je bojama Klimtovih slika.
So here we have the second portrait of Adela Bloch-Bauer, commissioned by her husband from Klimt in 1907, when Adela was in her late 20s, and shot through this, what is a fairly muted colour costume. We have the great blue, cobalt blue sash at her waist and fine details, highlights of blue throughout the costume. Another fascinating factor is the Japanese influence all around her. She stands these Japanese tapestries behind. Here with the horse and rider themes running across the top, we see probably Klimt using something that was hanging in his studio as a backdrop.
Ali u januaru 1925. godine domaćinstvo tone u tamu i očaj. Adela umire od zapaljenja mozga u svojoj 43. godini.
She died so very young. She was only in her early 40s and she was only sick like 3 days because meningitis is devilish. I mean, it hits you and it kills you. I remember her bedroom, which he converted into a memorial room. And he always had beautiful fresh flowers there all year round. And there was nothing but the Klimt paintings, the two portraits and the landscapes.
Ferdinand je bio slomljen. On je naredio da sobu njegove žene ostave u stanju u kom je bila na dan njene smrti. Ferdinand je također stavio fotografiju Gustava Klimta na njen noćni stočić. Adela je tačno znala šta je htjela da se dogodi sa slikama posle njene smrti. Njen testament je glasio: želja mi je da ostavim svoja dva portreta i 4 pejzaža Gustava Klimta muzeju Belvedere. Belvedere je prestižna austrijska nacionalna galerija, kojoj su svi iz visokog društva želili da ostave svoje portrete za opšte divljenje. Ova lepa barokna zgrada u centru Beča bila je omiljeno mesto okupljanja za bogate i slavne. Ali za sada slike ostaju u spomen sobi koju je Ferdinand napravio u spomen svoje supruge. Kako su prolazile 30. godine prošlog veka, izgledi za mir u Evropi su postajali sve krhkiji. Nacisti su došli na vlast u Nemačkoj. Hitlerove teritorijalne ambicije su ubrzo postale jasne. Ferdinand je bio predvideo nemačku nameru da napadne Austriju i pokušao je da iskoristi svoje bogatstvo za podršku organizovanju pokreta otpora radi zaštite njenih granica. Ali to se pokazalo uzaludnim. Godine 1938. Hitler je naredio aneksiju Austrije i nemačke trupe su ušle u Beč. Pre nego što su nacisti ušli u austrijsku prestonicu, Ferdinand je pobegao u svoju vilu preko granice u Čehoslovačku, ostavivši dragocene Klimtove portrete Adele sa ostatkom svoje umetničke kolekcije na zidovima svog bečkog doma. Dok je po poslednji put napuštao svoju kuću, prošao je pored Akademije likovnih umetnosti koja se nalazila tačno preko puta. Senka Hitlera je lebdela nad tim mestom, jer je to bila ta akademija koja ga nije primila 1907. Iste te godine kada je Klimt naslikao zlatni portret Adele. Hitler je možda napustio Beč kao propali umetnik, ali se u martu 1938. vratio pod potpuno drugačijim okolnostima. Bečki Jevreji su počeli da se boje zvuka kucanja na vratima.
They just came and took things, you know, they didn't ask you. They just rang the doorbell and I opened and there they were. They were not in uniform because it was Gestapo, you know, and they didn't wear uniforms. They immediately asked me for my jewelry, which I had just gotten from my uncle for my wedding present. It was Adele's beautiful diamond necklace with the earrings to match, and that went to Mrs. Göring.
Hermann Göring je bio jedan od glavnih arhitekata Trećeg Rajha, ere za koju je verovao da će doneti hiljadu slavnih godina nemačkih dostignuća. Kao aristokrata, on je smatrao muziku i umetnost za delove ovog velikog doba.
As in most things, the Nazis were very organized about their looting. When they were deciding which countries they were going to invade and what their plans for invasion were, they would send out spies or scouts, if you like, to see what collections were worth seizing, so that when they went into the country, once they invaded, they would immediately go after those collections. Every work of art was inventoried, it was described, it was photographed, and then displays were put on for some of the main Nazi leaders, for Hitler and for Göring, so that they could take their pick of the best of some of the world's art. There were sometimes disputes between Hitler and Göring as to who was going to get which painting or which sculpture, but there are extraordinary photographs that one can see today of Göring going round these special displays which were put on for him of all this stolen art. They seized every possible kind of collection. They were ready to exploit any work of art that was there. Obviously, some of the works of art were not to their taste, and they had certain ideological approaches to particular schools of art.
Nakon što su Bloch Baueru oduzeli fabrike, usmerili su svoju pažnju na njegovu umetničku zbirku. Tvrdili su da Ferdinand duguje velike svote za zaostali porez i poslali su izvesnog dr. Firera u kuću u Elizabethstrasse da organizuje jednu od najvećih pljački slika 20. veka. Dr. Firer je znao da su Hitler i Göring želeli nemačke slike Waldmillera za svoje privatne kolekcije, ali da ih nisu interesovale za njih dekadentne Klimtove slike. On je zato odlučio da ih proda.
It turned out later on that it was a terrific Nazi. His name was Dr. Führer and he had years in prison afterwards.
Dogovorio se sa muzejom Belvedere, Austrijskom nacionalnom galerijom, za dva Adelina portreta i jabuku. Breze je prodao jednoj drugoj galeriji, a kuće na jezeru je zadržao za svoju kolekciju. Belvedere je uvek tvrdio da ima punopravno vlasništvo nad slikama. Imali su priznanicu da su kupljene. Osim toga, to je bila želja koju je i sama Adela izrazila u svom testamentu. Sa Klimtovim slikama iz zbirke Bloch Bauera u njihovom posjedu, sada su bili u mogućnosti da organizuju jednu od najvećih izložbi Klimtovih radova ikada skupljenih na jednom mestu. Ali postojao je problem. Kako da prikažu portrete jevrejskih žena sada, kada je zemlja bila pod nacističkom vlašću?
To give the names of these women would in some ways give lies to the ideology of racial superiority that they were at that time promoting. So they were forced to omit or change the names of the paintings. So the portrait of Adele Bloch Bauer I became simply known as the Lady in Gold.
Ove tri Klimtove slike ostaju u Belvedereu do kraja rata. Kada su saveznici preuzeli kontrolu nad Bečom, sakupili su svu opljačkanu umetnost. Klimtovi iz Belvederea su ponovo bili u istom društvu sa slikom koju je dr. Firer prodao onoj drugoj galeriji i sa onom koju je on zadržao za sebe. Saveznici su svih pet odneli u Minhen da bi ih popisali.
I think, you know, one of the questions is what happened to this work, all these works of art at the end of the war, particularly the works of art that were in the hands of the Nazi leaders. And quite a lot of them were collected up by the Allies at the end of the war. As they were collecting up, they found all these depositories of looted art in Germany and Austria. And they then took them to collecting points where they did, I suppose, the reverse of the process that Germans had done at the beginning, which was they inventoried them, they photographed them, and they established where they had come from, with the help of the Nazi records, of course, and then decided to return them to the countries from which they had been taken. And those countries were charged with setting up commissions for restitution so that the works of art would then be returned to their rightful owners. The Allies didn't want to do that work themselves. In the case of the Goering collection, when they didn't know where they came from, they were subsequently given to German museums to hold. And today there are over 100 paintings from the Goering collection whose rightful owners have not been established yet.
Ova politika vraćanja ukradene umetnosti u zemlje njihovog porekla značila je da su sve Klimtove slike bile vraćene u Belvedere. I to istim onim ljudima koji su kupili prve tri od nacista. 1938. godine Bloch Bauer je imao u vlasništvu dve ogromne fabrike, palatu u Beču, dvorac u Čehoslovačkoj. Njegova zbirka se sastojala od 69 kapitalnih umetničkih dela. Na kraju nacističke vladavine nije mu ostalo ništa. Ferdinand je proveo posljednje godine svog života u Švajcarskoj. On više nikada nije video svoje drage slike. Umro je 1946. godine. Nekoliko godina kasnije, Marija i njen suprug su se doselili u Sjedinjene Američke Države sa malo novca koje im je preostalo. Marija je počela da šije žensku odeću u svom malom stanu u Los Angelesu. Kako su godine prolazile, posmatrala je kako Klimtovim slikama raste vrednost i kako postaju svetski poznate kulturne ikone.
In the United States during the 70s, Klimt paintings enjoyed a resurgence as dorm posters. They were The Kiss and the Portrait of Adela Bloch Bauer were hung in American college dorms alongside posters of Che Guevara or Jimi Hendrix or whatever. Somehow he came into vogue into American pop culture. So that painting was recognizable to many Americans.
Dok su Klimtove slike sada vredele milione dolara, Marija je još uvek pokušavala da sastavi kraj sa krajem šijući odeću. Ali uskoro će započeti bitku da povrati svoje porodično blago. Tokom 50 godina, Marija Altman nikada nije izgubila nadu da će jednog dana njena porodica povratiti retke i vredne Klimtove slike koje su nacisti ukrali. Činilo se da ima malo šansi, ali uskoro će se u Njujorku dogoditi nešto što će u potpunosti promeniti svet trgovine slikama. Godine 1998. Muzej savremene umetnosti pozajmio je neke radove Egona Schillea iz Austrijske galerije. Schilleovi naslednici su tvrdili da su slike bile opljačkane od strane nacista. Nakon izložbe, američki sud je zaplenio Schilleove slike.
The Schiele case in New York also raised the profile of this whole issue. It raised also the whole question of museums and what the role of museums had been and what the role of museums was today in this whole process. Many museums in Western Europe, in America, places that weren't occupied, in Australia and so on, did acquire knowingly, usually unknowingly, looted works of art. But up until this whole subject came onto the international agenda, and until there was a conference in Washington organized by the State Department in 1998, museums were quite, and art dealers, were, you know, quite freely trading in what may have been a looted work of art.
Slučaj Schiele odjednom je Mariju Altman uverio da je vreme da kontaktira advokata. Da li je došao trenutak da ospori Belvedere ovo vlasništvo nad slikama svoga ujaka i ujne?
They're never really... was an actual proof that these paintings belonged to the Belvedere. And then I called Randy.
Marija je poznavala porodicu Schemberg celog svog života. Arnold Schemberg je bio čuveni kompozitor i bio je deo društvenog kruga njene ujne. Ona se obratila njegovom nečaku, mladom advokatu Randyu Schembergu za pravni savjet.
She called me in September of 1998. I was working in a small office of a large New York-based firm. I looked online, relatively new activity at that time in 1998 at the Austrian newspapers, which had just become available like that, to see what was going on in Austria. So when she called me, I knew exactly what she was talking about, and that's really how it started.
Pošto je Rendijeva porodica također pretrpela pod nacistima, on je bio spreman da napusti dobro plaćen posao kako bi pomogao Mariji da podnese tužbu.
It was deeply personal because both of his grandfathers were exiled composers. His maternal grandfather lost his parents in the Holocaust. Maria had to flee Austria after the Anschluss when Germany and Hitler invaded Austria. So I would say that for them there was a lot of deeply personal feeling behind the case as they were proceeding.
Gustav Klimt je naslikao Adelu Bloch-Bauer 1907. godine. U svom testamentu, napisanom 1925. Adela je navela da njena dva portreta i četiri Klimtova pejzaža treba prepustiti Belvedereu, gde bi visili uz druge Klimtove portrete bogatih bečkih žena.
I think the point at this time was that the Austrian government was of the opinion that the last will of Adele gave the Austrian gallery clear title to the paintings.
Austrijska vlada je tvrdila da Belvedere ne posjeduje ni jedan opljačkani umetnički predmet i otvorila je svoje arhive da to dokaže. Austrijski novinar Hubertus Černin proveo je godinu dana u ovim arhivama istraživajući umetnička dela opljačkana od Jevreja. Pre nego što je umro, otkrio je niz ključnih dokumenata koji će preporoditi izglede da Marija Altman povrati slike svoje porodice.
Bertus Černin went into archives that had been closed to journalists and began to look at the records. When he was done, he wrote a investigative series for a newspaper in Austria that basically showed that the Austrians, even back into the 50s, were not as confident that the will gave them ownership of those paintings, and that they themselves thought that they should have gotten some kind of a signed permission from Ferdinand.
Iako je Adela ostavila slike Belvedereu, njen suprug je odlučio da ne ispoštuje njenu želju. On je bio taj koji je platio za slike i u njegovom testamentu je izričito navedeno da svi prethodni testamenti koji se odnose na Klimtove slike moraju biti proglašeni nevažećim.
He just left a will, leaving everything to my sister, me, and my brother. The last letter that exists from my uncle, written to the painter Kokoschka 2 days before he died, was, I am told that I might get maybe the portraits of my wife sent to me here. So that was the last letter of my uncle.
1999. Austrijski ministar kulture i obrazovanja, Elisabeth Gerer, preuzela je kontrolu i odmah zatvorila arhive. U zamenu, ona je najavila formiranje komiteta vlade koji bi doneo odluku o vlasništvu nad Klimtovim slikama.
We had a conservative government, right-wing government, and she was a member of the Conservative Party. She's not in power anymore. She wasn't the most popular person in the government, and a lot of her decisions have been doubted. So the Klimt case didn't help either to raise her popularity.
Ministarka Gerer i njen odbor postali su pravi trn u oku Rendiju i Mariji. Odbor nije hteo ni da pogleda njihove dokaze.
I begged them to come and be able to speak to them on Maria's behalf, and I was told, no, we've decided not to speak to any outside people, and they consider Maria and her attorney to be an outside figure in the case concerning her family's paintings, which I thought was remarkable. So we tried to influence this committee that was meeting and going to decide what would happen with the paintings, but to no avail. And then at the end of June of 1999, that committee recommended against returning the Klimt paintings.
They were hoping I'd die. I mean, I was old enough that they felt, and then it's finished. But I didn't do them that favor.
Minister Gerer actually wrote a public letter that was published in the newspaper, and I'm quoting her now. These paintings were not robbed during the war, and therefore they don't come under the new law. It's completely false, and I think she was just completely ignorant of the facts of the case, willfully ignorant, as I think many Austrians sometimes are, of the Nazi period. How is it possible that a minister of education can make that type of mistake?
Vladin komitet je odlučio u korist Belvederea i ministarka Gerer je podržala njihovu odluku.
I think Minister Gerer was convinced that Austria has got the right to keep the pictures. She didn't look at any other possibility. She just thought this is the way it has been handled in the past and the law is on our side and why should we give the pictures back? Because in the will of Adele Bloch-Bauer it said the pictures should actually be given to the Belvedere Gallery after her death.
Pet spornih slika su bili deo najveće kolekcije Klimta u svetu. Belvedere ima ukupno 25 izloženih. One su bile nacionalne ikone. Neki su čak rekli da portret Adele znači Austrijancima isto kao i Mona Lisa Francuzima. Klimt je bio austrijski slikar, koji je slikao kako svoj rodni kraj, tako i svoje bečke sugrađane. Za bilo kog turistu Klimtova zbirka je bila nešto što se moralo videti kada ste već u Beču. To je puno značilo i za austrijsku privredu.
I wrote them the nicest letters. I told them that I don't want to take those paintings away from Austria, but we have an English proverb I wrote in German that is saying, where there's a will, there's a way. And if you want to work with me, we can find a way that the paintings remain there. They never even bothered to answer the letter.
Pošto je ministarka Gerer blokirala svaku dalju diskusiju oko restitucije pet Bloch-Bauerovih Klimtova, Rendio je poslao pismo u kome joj je rekao da treba da razmotri arbitražu.
And her response to me was in writing, if you don't like the way we've dealt with the law, you have to go to court.
Austrijanci mora da su bili uvereni da Rendi i Marija neće podneti tužbu u Austriji, jer se od Marije zahtevalo da položi veliki depozit koji bi odražavao vrednost svih tih slika.
In this case it would have been almost several million dollars for Maria just to initiate a lawsuit. So we tried to reduce that and the judge said, "Well, yes, Maria Altman, you don't have to pay more than all everything you own. You just have to pay everything you own." And literally all of her assets other than her home, she would have had to pay to start the litigation in Austria, and then Austria appealed and said the amount should be even higher than that. So at that point, let's forget about suing in Austria. Let's see if we can sue in the United States.
Ali oni nisu računali na istrajnost američkog advokata. Dogodilo se nešto što Austrija nikada nije mislila da će biti moguće, da će Randy, kada već nije mogao da se bori protiv njih u Beču, podići tužbu protiv njih u svom rodnom gradu, Los Angelesu. Randy je shvatio potrebu da stalno vrši pritisak da bi podigao profil svoje tužbe. Prionuo je na posao da svetu skrene pažnju na nepravdu nanetu porodici Bloch-Bauer. Jedna od novina kojima se obratio je bio i Los Angeles Times.
I went over to Randall's office to meet the lawyer. He was in his early 30s. He looked like he just graduated from college. He was pacing around the office and pulling books out of bookshelves, showing me pictures, spreading things out like characters from a Russian novel. And I remember standing there thinking, this is a kind of case that's untested. I mean, I wouldn't say I thought it was a lost cause, but I certainly thought it was a case for which there was no legal precedent in the United States.
Ali na koji način je mogao tužiti Austriju? Tražio je i tražio način. Onda je otkrio da bi, ako dokaže da je Austrija zaradila novac od Klimtovih slika u Americi, mogao da ima šansu. Austrija je naravno obilno zarađivala na plakatima i knjigama o Klimtu.
I think we can file a lawsuit here in Los Angeles. Maria Altman's been a citizen here for 60 years. She should have the right to have her courts decide this legal issue between her and Austria. So I filed the complaint in August of 2000, and it didn't cost $2 million to file the complaint. It cost a few hundred. I think people thought it was sort of a quixotic effort, you know, that I was tilting at windmills and you know, to take on the Austrian government and sue in the United States to try to get back paintings that were in Vienna. seemed a little bit nuts, I must say, and I think most people who were looking at it thought I was a little bit crazy. But when I won the district court, people started taking a little more notice. But, you know, crazy things happen in the district court. It'll get corrected on appeal. But when I won in the Court of Appeal, then people started to really pay attention to the case.
6 godina nakon što je bio započeo parnicu, Randyjeva odlučnost ga je dovela pred sudije Američkog vrhovnog suda. Austrijskoj vladi nije nedostajalo sredstava da se parniči sve do najviše sudske instance u Americi.
Very few cases go to the Supreme Court, just about 80 cases per year, and so very rare that you'd get a private litigation like this going to the Supreme Court. And you know, you can count on a few hands the number of people in Los Angeles who get to do that type of thing.
Ali kako se datum za saslušanje pred Vrhovnim sudom približavao, Randy je saznao da se neće parničiti samo sa Austrijancima.
A number of other countries, including the Bush administration, wrote legal briefs basically supporting Austria's contention that the case shouldn't go forward in U.S. courts, that the U.S. was not the proper jurisdiction. Many countries don't want to see themselves in the same position, where they're being sued in a foreign court over an historic grievance that's 50 years old. I think probably many U.S. judges don't want to see those kinds of cases regularly in U.S. courts. Basically, when he went to go argue against Austria in the U.S. Supreme Court, the Bush administration had already cast a vote that was supportive of Austria.
February 2004, Randy je konačno dobio priliku da se suprotstavi i austrijskoj i svojoj vladi pred Vrhovnim sudom.
He's not a big guy, you know. And there's this huge room of the courtroom, you know. And there on this podium sat the judges. And then little Randy walked up there, you know.
Randy se iz sve snage trudio da ne bude zasenjen tim trenutkom.
I went up last after the U.S. government and the Austrian government argued. And so I got up, and you don't prepare a speech in the Supreme Court because they always interrupt you. So I just had a general outline of what I wanted to say, and I said, there are 4 grounds for affirming the Ninth Circuit. Ground one is, and then boom, I got interrupted by Justice Souter. And he asked me this long, long question, convoluted, twisting and turning question, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, like that. And all of a sudden, the question was over, and he's looking at me, and I had not the slightest idea what he had just asked me. Not a clue. All I could think of saying was, I'm sorry, Your Honor, I don't think I understood the question. Could you please rephrase it? And there were these gasps in the audience, you know. But the other justices were so nice, they all smiled as if to say, oh, don't worry, he does that all the time. Or, you know, thank goodness you asked because we didn't understand it either.
To je bila prekretnica. Daleko od toga da je to bila greška. Randy uspeva da ga sud gleda sa simpatijama.
That opened everything for him because all the other judges smiled. From that moment, he had the judges on his side.
It must have had a good impact, and it just seemed really, at the end of it, it seemed like we had a chance of winning, which was a big surprise. And so I just floated out of the room, and I was so happy, and everybody congratulated me.
The room was filled with men, all lawyers. They came running up to me and they said, Maria, it looks fabulous. And I said, how can you tell? Nobody said anything.
Randy je odletao nazad u Los Angeles, ne znajući da li je pobedio ili izgubio. Tek što je stigao kući, dobio je loše vesti.
I got home and I opened up the legal newspaper here in Los Angeles, and the headline was, Court likely to reverse Altman case, that we were going to lose. And so I called up the reporter, and I said, you know, how could you say this? Everybody thought it went so well. And he said, trust me, I've been reporting the Supreme Court for 35 years. You don't stand a chance. It's all over. I said, well, you know, some of the justices didn't even open their mouths. He says, I can tell by the body language. You lost.
Bilo je to još u proleće kada je branio svoj slučaj u Washingtonu. Sada je već bila jesen u Los Angelesu kada je Randy konačno saznao rezultat.
3 months later, I'm making breakfast for the kids and I get this call from the reporter. He says, hello, this is Dave Pike. And I said, okay, well, give me the bad news. He said, no, not bad news. You won. I said, you're kidding. He said, no, 6-3 decision by Justice Stevens. I literally couldn't believe it. But it was coming from him. I had to believe it. And so, you know, I tried to call Maria and her phone was busy and then we finally got together. And just, I mean, the celebration was enormous. But very quickly we realized, wait a second, what did we just win? Nothing, right? All we won was the right to start the case in Los Angeles. The paintings are still in Vienna. We hadn't won anything. We just won the right to start.
Možda je to bio samo početak za Randija, ali američki sud stavio i austrijske vlasti u težak položaj. Oni su bili nestrpljivi da odbace svoju nacističku prošlost. Međutim, sada je slučaj privukao interesovanje medija iz celog sveta.
Now the U.S. Supreme Court had basically weighed in and said, okay, well, you can hear it in U.S. court. U.S. courts tend to be more favorable in these cases. However, the Austrians could have appealed, as they had appealed some of the other decisions in the past. But to have this dragging on in the public view during these appeals as an issue that really at this point was not going to go away, I think was a very difficult quandary for the Austrians.
Nije austrijska vlada bila jedina u nezavidnom položaju. Randijev klijent Marija je sada već imala 89 godina. Da li je mogao da rizikuje dugačak sudski spor? Ako ona umre, spor je završen. Ona nije imala druge rođake koji žive u Sjedinjenim američkim državama koji bi mogli da nastave proces. Bilo je potrebno još godinu dana pregovora, ali na kraju su obe strane pristale na obavezujuću arbitražu.
I went behind closed doors with Maria and I said, Maria, this is the greatest thing. We can have this arbitration. We can get it finally finished. And by your 90th birthday, next February, it'll all be over with. And isn't that great? And she said, are you crazy? Why on earth would we go back to Austria when we've just been fighting for 5 years all the way to the Supreme Court and back to have the right to try the case in front of this wonderful judge here in Los Angeles?
I said, you're crazy. Why would 3 Austrian arbitrators go against their government and give us the paintings when for 8 years they kept saying? And he said, we have to take the chance.
Randall was very skillful at getting his side of the story out. I think he was more skillful than the Austrians in articulating his position in the media. So when the panel was deciding this case, it was another period of months and months that went by where they were still in this limbo. And you kind of thought anything could happen.
Još jednom Randy nije imao pojma da li je dobio ili izgubio. On se vratio u Los Angeles i 4 mjeseca kasnije dobio email poruku.
I came home late one night from a neighborhood poker game where I had lost my shirt and checked my email and sure enough there's an email from the main arbitrator with the decision. And so I opened up the decision and it's all in German, you know, and my German's pretty good, but it took me a while until I got to the, you know, the part where they said we won. And I was, you know, obviously overjoyed, but it was after midnight on a Sunday night, Monday morning. So I didn't call Maria right away. I let her sleep. And then in the morning this time we really celebrated.
It was very, very exciting because I couldn't imagine, and I still think it is incredibly just that these 3 Austrian judges unanimously vote for something which their government was so totally against.
Niko u Austriji nije mislio da to može da se desi. Oni su bili šokirani. Ove slike su njihove nacionalne ikone.
I think it was a wise decision, but it came too late. Of course, Klimt is national cultural heritage of Austria, and his paintings are famous, and we're proud of them. And he is Austrian, and he wanted them to stay in Austria. So Austria needed to find a solution, a diplomatic solution, and they knew they're going to be watched internationally on how they will handle this case. It could have been done smarter. It's done now, but it could have been done smarter and the damage could have been less.
I think you cannot take a better example for the style of Klimt than to compare the Adele Bloch-Bauer 1 with Adele Bloch-Bauer 2. I mean, we are very sad that from now on we do not have this possibility anymore in our museum. And this is very sad because this was such a fascinating comparison, which is so unique. Because you see not only the same person, only 5 years are in between these two portraits, but you see also the change of style, which is in this short period.
When finally the decision was made that the pictures will leave Austria, there was a national outcry. There was lots of criticism, and I was like, why do we have to give the pictures away? Why couldn't you find another way of handling this matter, of buying the pictures, you know, because everybody thought we would have enough money to get at least one of the pictures back, or two, but that wasn't the case. So a lot of people felt sad and felt about a missed chance, and so many people so many people went to the gallery to have a last look at the Klimt pictures.
One aspect on the Austrian side is a certain lack of coordination in this case, or maybe a lack of leadership. So I don't think they had a plan A, so they did not need a plan B.
Ova priča je počela 1938. godine, kada su nacisti opljačkali Bloch-Bauerove Klimtove u Beču. Slike su bile u austrijskom posjedu 68 godina. Po prvi put od kada su bile opljačkane, slike su napuštale Beč. 24. aprila 2006. godine, slike su stigle u grad gdje Marija živi i bile su izložene u Umetničkom muzeju Los Angelesa na jednoj od najpopularnijih izložbi koja je ikada tu bila organizovana.
When Maria first walked in and saw the paintings here, first of all she said they look so much bigger here, and I think it was wonderful for her to be able to have them here in Los Angeles where she settled, where she, you know, raised her family, to be able to share them with her family. And we also have a great collection in this city of German and Austrian art of this period, so it would have had a marvelous context as well.
Ovo je bila konačna pobjeda za Mariju. Ali umjesto da ih zadrži kao porodično nasljeđe, ona je odlučila da ih proda. Slikama nije bilo suđeno da ostanu u galeriji u Los Angelesu i one su opet krenule na put, ovog puta za New York. Bogati kolekcionari iz celog sveta okupili su se u Rockefellerovom centru. Klimtove slike su išle na aukciju.
There's been a lot of interest. They've been on view for the past 4 days and we've had record figures through. 3-4 times the number of people who normally come through our exhibition rooms have been arriving. So I think from that we can gauge that there's strong interest.
I posle te duge pravne bitke, zašto je Marija odlučila da ih proda? Čini se da je glavni faktor bila bezbednost. Kako bi ih Marija mogla zaštititi?
These paintings now have become so valuable that the heirs really didn't have the ability to keep them themselves, and this is really a way for Ferdinand and Adela's heirs to transform this inheritance into something that they can actually use for other good purposes. And I know that they all have really terrific things that they're going to be doing with the money for it. So I hope the sale goes well and that they find good homes. And it doesn't bother me necessarily if they go into private collections. These were, after all, private property. And it's only because of this history that they were in the Austrian Museum for so many decades. But they belonged to Ferdinand Bloch-Bauer, and he willed them to his family. And now, just like any inheritance, whether it be stock or cash, paintings or whatever, they're entitled to do with it what they want.
You so seldom see pictures of this quality come to the market, and to have four at one time is something very special indeed. I think each picture has its own particular facets that will attract different clients, and their general importance is something that has been recognized by collectors far and wide.
Marija se borila celog života da bi povratila te slike. a držala ih je u vlasništvu samo nekoliko mjeseci. Da li joj je bilo žao što slike nisu ostale u Beču?
Well, I mean, I wasn't willing to donate it because I think the Belvedere had the paintings for 68 years and there was no reason to make a donation after that. But he could negotiate just like everybody else will do.
Maria Altman didn't even want the pictures. She didn't want them for her living room. She wanted them actually to stay in Austria, but she couldn't find another way to do it. And she said, look, if you want to buy the pictures, fair enough. If you don't, we're going to take them.
Ne samo da je Kristijeva aukcijska sala bila prepuna, već su i ponude iz celog sveta dolazile telefonom. Prva slika je Klimtova Brezova šuma.
And still better, 36 million. At $36 million, all done and selling right at $36 million. Mark, your bidder at $36 million. Second, Klimt, the Attersee landscape there, lot 52, was illustrated in your catalogues. At $28 million, it's still up front, against you here, and selling this time, all done, at $28 million. For you, madam, $28 million. Lot 53 is the third Klimt, apple tree number one. $29,500,000. $29,500,000. Selling this side for $29,500,000. Lot 54. The fourth Klimt there. Portrait of Adele Bloch-Bauer II. It's the 1912 portrait. $65 million. $67 million. $67,500,000. $68 million.
Kod cene od 68 miliona dolara ostala su dva konkurenta. Koliko daleko će ići?
70 million 500,000. 71 million. 72 million. 73 million.
Ali tren pre nego što je čekić trebalo da padne?
74 million new bidder. At $74 million. New bidder. At $74 million. 75 million. 76 million, 77 million, 77 million 500,000, 78 million, 78 million 500,000. That's $78 million $500,000 on this telephone, fair warning and selling, all done at $78 million 500,000. Guy, you're better at $78 million 500,000.
It felt tremendous. There was sort of an energy in the room when the paintings came up that I think was a response to the story itself, the background of the pictures, not just the pictures as art. And I felt that electricity in the air. I was sitting there. At least that's how it felt to me.
Te tri Klimtove slike su dostigle neverovatnih 172 miliona dolara. Gde su sada? To je misterija. Kristi po običaju ne objavljuje ko su kupci. A gde je bila najpoznatija slika od svih? Zlatni portret Adele. Ova slika je trebalo da bude na aukciji sa ostalima. Ali to se nije dogodilo, jer je bila prodata 3 mjeseca ranije za rekordnih 135 miliona dolara Ronaldu Lauderu, američkom kralju parfema.
When Ronald Lauder was in Vienna, and he saw that painting. He said he never forgot it. Of course, he'd already seen reproductions of it before. And I think that Lauder's reaction was similar to everyone's reaction, including my own, which was when I saw a picture of the painting that was under discussion, my first reaction was, oh, that painting. And I think everyone has pretty much the same reaction.
U slučaju Marije Altman radilo se pre o pravdi nego o posjedovanju, tako da ona nije želela da zadrži slike. Ona ih je prodala. Sve ukupno slike su donele nešto više od 325 miliona dolara. Žena u zlatu prodata je Ronaldu Lauderu za 135 miliona dolara, s tim da slika bude permanentno dostupna javnosti u Lauderovoj Neue galeriji u Njujorku. Marija je uporno odbijala da se sama okrene luksuzu koristeći svoje novozarađene milione. Ona nije kupila ni novi automobil, niti je preuredila svoju kuću. Umjesto toga, ona je formirala fondaciju i poklonila milione dolara, uglavnom muzejima i kulturnim institucijama u Los Angelesu. Ona je takođe ustanovila stipendiju za ambiciozne operske pevače u čast svog pokojnog supruga. Dodatne svote novca su razdeljene tim ustanovama nakon njene smrti 2011. godine, neposredno pre njenog 95. rođendana. Randy Schoenberg je pristao da zastupa Mariju bez nadoknade. Da su izgubili, ali kao što znamo, oni su pobedili i on je po dogovoru dobio 40% prihoda od prodaje slika, ili oko 120 miliona dolara. Kao i Mari Altman, Randy je poklonio značajne sume u dobrotvorne svrhe, rekavši: ja sam pokušao da uradim dobre stvari sa novcem. On je dao najmanje 7 miliona dolara Muzeju holokausta u Los Angelesu, čiji je on sada počasni direktor. I kao Marija, on također izbegava luksuz. I dalje ne mogu da sebe naterem da letim prvom klasom u avionu, kaže on, iako to sada mogu sebi da priuštim.